This is Kevin Patton with another study tip for human anatomy and physiology. This time I'm talking about concept maps. This is a learning and study strategy that's been around for thousands of years, even though some people claim to have invented it just within the last few years. All it is a picture, a drawing of a concept, or of different related concepts in a way that maps it out so that you can understand it. It fits your own learning style or your own way of thinking. For this reason, concept maps are often called mind maps. It provides a way to put the ideas together yourself rather than the way the textbook author or the lab manual author or your instructor or your study partner does it. If you put it together in a way that makes sense to you, then it's easier to learn. And as you put together this picture, it also helps you identify weak areas. Why is that? Because you can't complete the picture unless you know where all the parts fit. Now what this does is it helps us climb up the learning pyramid. At the base of the pyramid is the simple idea of remembering facts. But as you probably already know, you need to know more than just the facts. You need to be able to put them together in ways that are useful. And that's what a concept map does. It helps us put together the facts in ways that show relationships and thus help us better understand those deeper meanings, those applications and relationships that allow us to understand the concepts. So here are some examples. This is one you're probably all familiar with, and that is a flowchart. A flowchart are simply steps in a process where one thing follows another. You can see in this flowchart that there's an invader that comes into the body, and there's all kinds of immune system reactions that happen after that. But by drawing it out in a flowchart, we can see what triggers what, and by looking from side to side, we can see that there are multiple things going on at one time. And so I think we can take all those isolated facts from the immune system and start to understand how they work together as a system when we draw ourselves a map like this. Another style of concept map would be a circle diagram. Here's a diagram showing you some of the components of a homeostatic feedback loop. And we see the controlled variable at the top, and we know that that variable is sensed by a sensor, and then there's feedback to an integrator, which then may control an effector, which has an effect on the controlled variable. So the circle is completed. In biology in general, and certainly in human biology, there are a lot of different processes that go in a circle like this. And so this style of a chart or this style of a concept map would make sense for those concepts. Another style you might want to use is a tree diagram. This is a tree diagram that incorporates outlines. So we have the overall idea of cellular respiration, so we'll write that first on our paper, and then we'll draw branches of a tree. Each of the branches of the tree contains a little mini outline that summarizes important parts. Now, in this particular case, we're looking at the anaerobic pathway and the aerobic pathway and comparing and contrasting them. A very simple idea, but by putting it out on paper, it helps solidify our understanding of it and the relationship between these two pathways. Another kind of a tree diagram, just to show you that there are many kinds of trees in the forest, would be this one here that shows a kind of a sideways tree, where again we're showing cellular respiration to begin with, and notice at this time that I've highlighted that level of the tree with the label process. So that's telling us, well, what's the overall process we're looking at? And then in the next layer of the tree, the next layer of branching, I've identified that as two pathways and then specifically listed one in each branch. And then in the third box over to the far right there, I've labeled that area or that level of the tree characteristics. And we see all the little branches there would be those characteristics that in the previous diagram had been shown as part of an outline, but here they're shown as separate branches. Again, this can get to be a lot more complex as you add information during your learning, but I'm showing you very simplified concept maps just to kind of get you started. Yet another version of a tree diagram would be this one that's almost exactly like the previous one, except that I've flipped it around, so now it's an upside down tree. So my point here is that you can draw these any way you want. You can draw them from top to bottom, from side to side, from bottom to top, and so on. It just depends on what makes sense to you, and you can add to it and maybe even start to go up and then tilt sideways as you need more room and add more concepts. Another style of concept map would be a spoke diagram, sometimes called a radial diagram. And this is where you would put the central idea, well, in the center. And then you would add spokes. Now here I've only added three spokes, but you can imagine that you would add spokes going all the way around in 360 degrees. And then each of those spokes could have their own spokes that go out in a circle. And then each of those spokes could have another spoke. So again, you can add many layers of complexity here depending on what you want to do with this and how much information there is that you want to put into one diagram. Now, as you're doing your concept maps, it's not a bad idea to add sketches. And, you know, I'm not the best artist in the world, and yet I can still draw little stick diagrams and squares and circles and so on. My squares may not be exactly square, and my circles may not be perfectly round, but, you know, it works good enough because the whole idea is to go through the process of making the concept map, because by doing that, we're pulling out the relationships and seeing how they are. Now, when we're finished with the concept map, we do have a reference that we can go back to and review and study and maybe even add to. But really, most of the learning is in putting it together in the first place. Now, that doesn't mean you want to throw away when you're done, because we certainly do want to use it as a reference, but the goal is not future reference. The goal is to put it together, and by putting it together, you learn relationships. So if you're looking for ideas on how to do a concept map on a particular concept that maybe you're struggling with, there's some ideas that you can get from places that you already have available to you. For example, your textbook, I'm sure, is full of different styles of concept maps on different topics and so on. So take a look there. And there's nothing wrong with just, you know, making your own version of a diagram that's already in the book. Your lab manual will also have concept maps in it. Your instructor may give you handouts or other resources, or you can go ask them to get you started and give you some ideas. Your Learning Center tutors or other tutors you might have available will help get you started, may have some examples for you to look at, or could, you know, really help you walk through your first few concept maps so you get the idea of how to do it. Do this with other students. That's one of the best ways to learn, is to get together in your study group and figure out, okay, we need a concept map on this topic or that topic. How are we going to do it? And throw around some ideas and fine-tune them and do it as a group project. Another option would be look on the web. There are a lot of people that have posted their own concept maps, or at least you can look and see what kinds of diagrams there are out there on particular topics, and that might help give you the idea for doing your own. Now, there are lots of tools that you can use to make this whole process of making a concept map easier and also more effective, because after all, that's the goal, right, is to be effective. So for simple drawings, just using a pen and paper. Now, I recommend trying to get a stack of that larger paper. You can get this at your copy center, probably your school bookstore, something like that, would have 11 by 17 inch paper, or maybe legal size paper, which isn't quite as big, but it's bigger than your standard size paper. The bigger the paper you start with, the more room you have, and you can always fold it up like a map. I know some people that use wrapping paper or butcher paper or something like that, and just pull it out in a big long roll and draw it, and then fold it up in little piece like a road map and stick it in their folder. I recommend that you use lots of colors and maybe different kinds of drawing tools. You can use highlighters to color code different areas or different processes. Use colored pencils or colored markers to highlight different things. And then you'll want to also think about cutting and pasting from your textbook. You can photocopy or scan things from your textbook and paste it into your concept map. And that would, I think, be considered fair use, because you're using it for your own personal purposes. And you've already purchased the book, right? You can also go on the web and try to find some web images that might be useful and print those out and then cut and paste those into your concept map also. There are also different bits of software that you can get. Just a couple of them I've mentioned here, FreeMind and WebSpiration. These are things you can either download or operate fully on the web. On my website, which I'll give you the URL for later, I have a whole list of different mind mapping software, including online versions that you don't have to download and install. So you might want to try playing around with some of those, and those might work out very well for you. What I used for a lot of the images that you see in this presentation are the tools already built into Microsoft Office. They're called SmartArt tools. And as a matter of fact, with those, you can type in all your information and then just select different formats, and it'll automatically convert the information you've already typed in into, a radial, and then switch it to a tree diagram and switch it from that to maybe a flowchart diagram and so on. So a lot of these software computer tools are really easy to use and give you a lot of flexibility for the style and format and even colors. So if you want to learn more about how to use concept maps and for more links and so on, go to the URL at the top of the screen. And just for general study tips, you can always visit me at theapstudent.org.